begin our divine service with a moment of silent prayer. Let us begin our divine service and unite our voices and sing together hymn number 384. Number 384. Key text for this morning we find in Esther 4, verse 13 and 14. Esther 4, verse 13 and 14. And in it we read, "Then Mordecai commanded to answer Esther, Think not with thyself that thou shalt escape in the king's house more than all the Jews. For if thou altogether holdest thy peace at this time, then shall their enlargement and deliverance arise to the Jews from another place. But thou and thy father's house shall be destroyed, and who knoweth whether thou art come to the kingdom for such a time as this." With these words, let us kneel, and we'll ask Brother Auckland Wallace to lead us to the throne of grace.
Almighty God, our dear Heavenly Father, we are grateful, Lord, that you woke us up this morning We want to thank you for the night's rest and for the traveling mercies that you have granted to us today. But Lord, more than all, we ask for a special blessing on every knee that has bent here and every family that we represent.
Amen.
We pray for those who are absent for one reason or the other, and that the same blessing may be bestowed upon them. Be with our youth especially, Lord, because we know that the devil is roaring like a lion, devouring them. May we be as parents. Would you give us the necessary strength that we may set the right example for them to follow? And that as we go about, Lord, in our various chores from day to day, that others may see a bit of us, of Christ, reflecting in us.
Amen.
Strengthen us, Lord, and so that when you shall return in the clouds of glory, that every one of us bow here shall be ready to go home to spend an eternity with you. For we do ask these mercies in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
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 Well, I'd like to welcome everyone here this beautiful Sabbath morning, especially all our visitors from far and near. Some of the names were already mentioned in Sabbath school. We have Brother Mikey visiting home again from the Washington area. We have Brother Auckland Wallace from Florida. We have the Skorich family from North Carolina. Patrick and his family from Florida still, right? And Brother Evan Evans from Florida also. We have a lot of the visitors here because there will be a council meeting starting tomorrow, Sunday and Monday. And let us pray for the success of this meeting also, that the decisions that are made may be done for God's honor and glory. I understand there will be others that will be traveling also coming to this meeting. Let us pray also for traveling mercies. You know, mercy comes from God. And as in the Sabbath school, we should also show mercy to others that we come in contact with. And who are the others that we come in contact with? Who are they? Our neighbors, right? Our neighbors. And also, I wanted to thank the Moreno family for coming home from North Carolina. So there might be some that I've missed, but it's not on purpose. Sometimes when you're up front and you're looking, you know, your mind goes everywhere and you want to include everyone, but you don't want to leave anyone one out also. There are a couple announcements that we do have is, of course, prayer meetings on Wednesdays at 7 p.m. This afternoon at 3 o'clock will be the Holy Communion for the members of the Roanoke Church. Let us prepare and be here for that. And then also at 6 p.m. after Sabbath closing, there will be a church reorganization meeting. So I want all members to be there so that we can meet quorum and conduct the Lord's business. Also, right after the divine service, we have an important meeting also, which is lunch, fellowship meal, and where we can communicate and counsel one another. Also, coming up in beginning of December, December 9th, is the cooking class, right? Or the health class. Let us remember that and jot it down in our schedules. And it will be here in the building. Week of prayer also begins the beginning of December. So, you know, the weekends and the days are starting to fill up with different events that going toward the end of the year looks like it's filling up rapidly. So let us prepare ourselves for these different events. At this time, we will ask the usher to come forward and collect our tithes and offerings. Thank you. May the Lord richly bless the gift and the giver. At this time, we have a special item, and we have a musical quartet. And we'll ask those responsible to come forward. We thank them for that beautiful item. At this time, we will go over to our study hour, and we have the privilege of having Brother Homero Paredes with us, and he will break the bread of life to us for such a time as this.
Good morning, happy Sabbath. I bring greetings from our brethren in Florida, and the weather there is much warmer than here. So I bring warm greetings to you. One of the most encouraging books of the Bible is the book of Esther. This morning I would like to bring you to the story of this woman. That is an inspiration for not only for the young people, but for us adults as well. I invite you to open your Bibles to the book of Esther in chapter 4, verses 13 and 14. Esther 4, 13 and 14 said, "Then Mordecai commanded to Esther, Then Mordecai commanded to answer Esther, Think not with thyself that thou shalt escape in the king's house, for than all the Jews, or more than all the Jews. For if thou altogether hold thy peace at this time, then shall their enlargement and deliverance arise to the Jews from another place, but thou and thy father's house shall be destroyed, and who knoweth whether thou art come to the kingdom for such a time as this." So this is Mordecai sending a message to Queen Esther and warning her of the situation that was going on. You know that the jealousy of one man caused that the entire nation was going to be destroyed, or entire people. They were living in Persia at that time. And then by providence, Esther became the queen. Now, when the decree was issued against God's people, then Mordecai sent a message to her, saying, "Think not with thyself." And this is a good expression because many times we try to find an excuse for not to doing God's will. So this is a human tendency that we have. And Mordecai said, "Think not with thyself that thou shalt escape in the king's house." And at the end of verse 14 say, Who knows whether you are come to the kingdom for such a time as this. So that was a very difficult time in which the Jewish people were going through. And there was a need for a strong person, a determined individual, to go and be used as an instrument by God to rescue God's people or to deliver God's people from the decree. So that was an inspiration for Esther when she received the message from her uncle. And you know the story, how she bravely did what Mordecai told her to do, and deliverance came to God's people. I was impressed also by the faith manifested by Mordecai. He said, if you do, okay, praise the Lord, but if you don't, he said, deliverance will come anyways. So he was confident that God will deliver his people. And we have the same confidence today, you know. Deliverance will come to God's people. Today, the truth is like a bound. You know, most of the people that profess the truth, they are small, they are not the most wealthiest, they are they're not the most educated, they're limited in a sense. But deliverance will come to God's people. Now, who will be used as instrument to deliver God's people? This is the question that we need to. And Esther, action is an inspiration for all of us, especially for the young people. Now, who is Esther? This story we learned when we were a child. But let us read from chapter 2, the same book, chapter 2 and verse 7, to see pretty much who Esther was. Esther 2:7 said, "And he brought up Hadassah, that is Esther, his uncle's daughter, for she had neither father nor mother, and the maid was fair and beautiful, whom Mordecai, when her father and mother were dead, took for his own daughter." So notice here that Esther was an orphan. She had no father, no mother. So in such a condition, you know, a young people can go in a wrong way. But by God's grace, you know, she maintained faithful. And one of the qualities that mentioned here, she was fair and beautiful. So all these things may have been a cause of fall in any ordinary young person. But on the contrary, she was not. She remained faithful to God. So we can come to the conclusion that Esther was a virtuous woman. And the wise men say, who can find a virtuous woman? Who can? Beauty is being used today as a commercial tool, right? So this is something, and I'm sure that this is not new. This has been for generations after generations. But the wise men also mention about this thing in Proverbs chapter 31 when he speaks about the virtuous woman. In verse 29, we can apply this verse to Esther. Proverbs 31, verse 29 says, "Many daughters have done virtuously, but thou excellest them all." Favor is deceitful and beauty is vain. But a woman that feareth the Lord, she shall be praised. So what a wonderful statement here. It said, she recognized, talking about Esther, recognized that beauty is vain and favor is deceitful. So what is the actual value of a human being? Say the fear of the Lord. It said, the woman that feared the Lord, she shall be praised. So Esther was a woman of prayer. You know, when she received this recommendation from her uncle, what did she do? Going back to Esther chapter 4 and verses 15 and 16, it said, "Then Esther bade them return Mordecai this answer. Say, go, gather together all the Jews that are present in Shushan, and fast ye for me, and neither eat nor drink these 3 days, nine or day. I also and my maidens will fast likewise, and so will I go into the king, which is not according to the law, and if I perish, I perish." So the moment came when she was so determined to do God's will, to be used as instruments in the Lord's hands, that she was willing to die. He said, "I will go to the king even if it's not according to the law. But if I perish, I perish." So she was willing to sacrifice her own life. So what a legacy she has left to all the young people today. You know, what a legacy. I wish we can have many Esthers here, that we should follow the same inspiration and be faithful to the Lord. And through Esther, the Lord, she was the queen, and you know, a queen mostly is affected by vanity, or she is may think that, you know, I am the queen, so I am the first lady and so forth, so I am need of nothing, so I can have my way. But she didn't think that way. She called upon Mordecai and said, go and fast for me, how many days? 3 days. And I myself will do it, and my maidens, she said. He said, through Esther the queen, the Lord accomplished a mighty deliverance for his people through this woman. The Lord, and that's what Mordecai said, for such a time like this. She knew that providences had made it possible that she became the queen. Then the time of opportunity came, and she did not fail to fulfill God's willing. Now, in Volume 5, Testimonies for the Church, page 450, it says here, the decree which is to go forth against the people of God will be very similar to that issued by Ahasuerus against the Jews in the time of Esther. So notice carefully here. Said the decree that was issued at that time, in the time of Esther, will be very similar to the time that was issued, or the decree that was issued by the king of Persia at that time. So what does he tell you? That we need Esther today, right? We need young people to stand for the principle, to stand in the right way, to be used by God. So for such a time like this, the Lord is waiting for the youth of today. I want to bring you to a prophecy for these last days. You know, if you look in the book of Daniel, Daniel chapter 12, we find the prophecy about the last days. Daniel chapter 12, let's begin reading from verse 1. Daniel 12 and verse 1, he said, and at that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince which standeth for the children of thy people. And there shall be a time of trouble, such as never was since there was a nation, even to that time. And at that time thy people shall be delivered, everyone that shall be found written in the book. So notice here that in the time of the time of trouble, they say God will bring deliverance. And keep in mind that the Lord has always used instruments to deliver his people. Now, who will be used as instruments? That's what I want to focus this morning. And verse 2, they say, and many of them that are asleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life and some to shame and everlasting contempt. Verse 3, and they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament, and they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever. But thou, Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book even to the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased. So this last statement here is, and knowledge shall be increased. This is one of the greatest evidence that we are living in the time of the end. Then now, in this time, deliverance will come to God's people. But it broke my attention, verse 13, same chapter, Daniel 12 and verse 13. There is another prophecy here. He said, but go thou thy way till the end be, for thou shalt rest and stand in thy lot at the end of the days. So God is telling here, I mean, not that Daniel will resurrect in this time, but he said, you will stand, you will be standing. So there will be people like Daniel, like Esther, standing in this generation. This is what is going to happen. And it's in verse 3, compare this type of people. He said, as the stars, they will shine as the brightness of the firmament, and they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever. What a wonderful time we are living, brethren. We have been called for a special purpose in this generation. Are we conscious of that responsibility we have? Do we know our calling? Do we know what the Lord planned to do in this last time? So in the book of Acts, there is another indication of the fulfillment of this prophecy. Acts chapter 2 and verse 17. This is what the Holy Spirit says through his servant Peter, speaking at that time, Acts chapter 2, verse 17, he said, "And it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams." So notice carefully here the very important role of the young people in the last days. He said, "I will put out my spirit upon all flesh," but especially mentioned here, "and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy." And there is a special gift given to the young men here. "And your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams." So this is what happened in the generation that we are living. So for such a time like this, God is willing, or he's looking for volunteers. He's looking for young people that will be able to stand like Esther, like Daniel, and put their own life at risk to defend the truth. In the book Education, page 178, it said, "The history of nations that one after another have occupied their allotted time and place, unconsciously witnessing to the truth of which they themselves knew not the meaning, speak to us today. To every nation and to every individual of today, God has assigned a place in his great plan." So God has assigned something for every single one of us. He said, "Today, men and nations are being measured by the plummet in the hand of him who makes no mistake." So the same message that was sent to Esther in the kingdom is being delivered to us as well. He said, "Don't think in yourself that you will escape. Don't find excuses. Don't try that you will escape of what is coming upon this world." So whichever way you are, if you are in the kingdom, if you are found in a university, if you are found leading in any company of this world, if you are found as a teacher, if you are found doing whatever you're doing, he said, for such a time like this, God is calling you to witness for me, to be able to stand, to call seen by the right name, and to stand in the sight of the right. He said, "To every nation and to every individual of today, God has assigned a place in his great plan." So now the question is, what am I going to do? You know, Esther could have found many excuses or many ways to say, "Look, you do whatever you can. I am here at the kingdom, so I will not be touched. I am the wife of the king, you know, so I have advantages." So she didn't say that. He said, "No, this is my problem. This is my responsibility." He said, "Okay, I will fast for 3 days. Go ahead and fast you for me. And I will go. You know, I will stand for the right. And if I perish, I perish." You know, so now this prophecy that we read in Acts chapter 2, it said, in the last days, it shall come to pass, he said, "In the last days, I will pour my spirit upon, you know, all flesh, and your sons and your daughters will play a very special role." He says, yeah, "They shall prophesy, and your young men," says, "shall see visions today." We know that there is a decree coming upon God's people, or against God's people. So the church is in need of Esther's. Mm-hmm. In Conflict and Courage, page 244, he said, "To every household and every school, to every parent, teacher, and child upon whom has shone the light of the gospel, comes at this crisis the question put to Esther, the queen, at the time when the crisis in Israel's history, say, who knows whether you had come to the kingdom for such a time as this. So this question is not just to ask to Esther. It's asked to every single one. He said here, to every parent, to every teacher, to every child, to every young person, the question that was asked to Esther is, who knows if you are in such a place for a special moment, for the time of opportunity. So this is the challenge for today, brethren. So are we willing to do what is right? Are we willing to stand for the right? Does the heaven fall? This is the question. At the same time, you know, Satan is as a roaring lion seeking who to devour. So this is what Peter, chapter 5, verse 8, he said, be sober, be watchful. For your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. Who do you think is the target of Satan in this last generation? Yeah, the youth, the young people, they are the target of Satan. And the way the Bible presents, you know, the persecution against the youth, the persecution against the Esthers and the Daniels, is that he is as a roaring lion. Now, a lion is one of the most aggressive animals of the. This is why it is called the king of the jungle, you know, a lion. And the Bible even said that a lion, he said, he will not lay down until he eats of the prey. So when he goes after you, he will get you, and he will not lay down until he gets you and eats you. So, you know, when if a lion go after you, you better pray, you know, for mercy, because he will not, and this is found in Numbers 23:24, he said that, behold, the people rises up as lioness, and as a lion doth he lift himself up. He shall not lay down until he eat of the prey and drink the blood of the slain. So this is some of the characteristics of the lion. So the Bible itself is using that Satan is as a roaring lion seeking who to devour. And our young people is the target, is Satan's target. when the lion roar, you can hear it about 6 to 7 kilometers of the distance. So this is a very strong roar. And when he does that, it's like he's upset. He's claiming for his territory. He feels himself threatened. Or also when he goes after someone, after a prey, he roars. So then you be, a lion has the capability that he can see at night when we cannot. You know, he has his vision is more developed than men 6 times. So he can even see you at night from a distance. So imagine how dangerous a lion is. And it says Satan is after us as what? As a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. So at this time, more than ever, we need to be true shepherds, especially parents here, faithful shepherds. And like he says here, be watchful, be sober, because the devil is after your young people seeking to devour them. So it's very, very difficult time in which we are living today. I like the experience of David when he was, before he became the king, he was a shepherd, you know, and in the occasion when he went to fight with Goliath, you know, when the news was given to Saul, he said, there is a young man that is willing to go and fight Goliath. He said, okay, bring it to me. And then the question is, how can you dare to go and fight with this? You know, you cannot fight this man. You know, you are a young person And this man has been a war man till his youth. But then what was the credentials that David presented to Saul? Let's go to 1 Samuel 17. 1 Samuel chapter 17. In verse 33, it says that, and Saul said to David, thou art not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for thou art but a youth, and he is a man of war from his youth. In 34, it said, and David said unto Saul, thy servant was keeping his father's sheep, and when there came a lion or a bear, and I took a lamb out of the flock, I went after him and smote him and delivered it out of his mouth. And when he arose against me, I caught him by his beard and smote him and slew him. So notice, wow, David was a very brave man. You know, he was able to go after a lion, not a lion after him. Why? When he came and took one of the lambs, say, a good shepherd, what does he do? Run away? No, he needs to go after, you know. And he went and took it out of his mouth. You know, that really take courage. You know, we heard about Samson, that he was able to kill a lion, but we never knew about David. That's what he says here. He said, and when there came a lion or a bear, I took a lamb out of the flock, I went after him and I smote him and delivered it out of his mouth, and so forth. So, and 1 Samuel 17 and verse 36 said, thy servant smote both the lion and the bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine shall be as one of them, seeing ye had defiled the armies of the living God. And David said, Jehovah that delivereth me out of the paw of the lion and out of the paw of the bear, he will deliver me out of the hand of this Philistine. And Saul said unto David, go, and Jehovah shall be with thee. So with this credential, you know, when Saul was satisfied, he said, yeah, this is a really, really brave man, so you can go and fight Goliath, and the Lord be with you. Now, keep in mind that David did not go after a lion in his own strength. That he says that Jehovah delivered me. And we are the same, brethren. You know, we cannot accomplish anything in this world unless the Lord is with us. Esther knew that her influence in the kingdom was not be sufficient. He said, go and fast for me. How many days? 3 days. I will fast as well. So she depended upon prayer. Upon prayer. And if we apply the same principle that Satan is seeking the young people to devour them, we need to be wise men and wise as shepherds, as David was, and deliver our lambs out of the hands of Satan. Who are the lambs? Remember when Peter was asked by Jesus 3 times, lovest thou me? And he said, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Then what was the reply by Jesus? He said, feed my lambs. Who are the lambs? The lambs are the youth, you know, the children, the young people. You know, I am encouraged here because I see that half of the church is a youth, the young people. You know, so what are we going to do with them? Are we going to leave them alone or allow Satan to take them out? No. Say, we must do like David. They say, go after him. Take him out of the mouth. You know, when we see out of the youth going in the wrong direction, do we criticize them? Do we push them away? Or we just, no. We need to go like David and take him out of their mouth, up on the lion, and put them safe. You know, that was a commission given to Peter and to every adult here present this morning. It says, the first work that Christ entrusted to Peter on restoring him to the ministry was to feed the lambs. This was a work in which Peter had little experience. So Peter didn't have much experience. And many times we don't have that whole lot of experience either as parents. You know, why? He said it would require great care and tenderness, much patience and perseverance. So these three elements are very, very important. It says here, great care and tenderness, and patience and perseverance. So all these things are necessary so we can feed the lambs of the Lord. And by God's grace, this prophecy can be fulfilled that in these last days, he said, God will put out his spirit upon the young people and they will do great, great things. Unfortunately, today, many, many young people are found in neutral position. Jesus said, he that is not with me is against me. So you see the young people delaying their commitment with the Lord. You know, they say, oh, this is not a good time. Maybe next year or maybe, and so forth. You see that, say that he that is not with me is against me. And in volume 4, Testimony for the Church, page 199, it said, the fearful state of the youth of this age constitutes one of the strongest signs that we are living in the last days. So it says here, the state of the youth, it said, but the ruin of many may be traced directly to the wrong management of the parents. Many times it's the wrong management of parents that place the youth in a condition that they don't want to take their stand. He said, as I look upon the perilous situation of our youth and was shown how indifferent the parents are to their welfare, my heart was sick and faint. So angels were troubled and wept with grief. The youth are passing into the world and into the hands of Satan. So this was a Sister White writing in volume 4, page 199 and page 200. It says, so I saw Satan planting his banner in the household of those who profess to be God's chosen ones. She saw that. I saw Satan doing this thing. So what are we going to do is my question today. You know, I saw Satan planting these things. He said, but those who are walking in the light should be able to discern the difference between the black banner of the adversary and the black stained standard of Christ. So this is very serious. You know, when they said, Sister White said, when I saw the condition of the youth, he said, I fainted. It was something that really created such an impression upon her that she felt so so bad. And we forget that our first duty of us as a parent is to bring the children to Christ. Remember when Jesus, they brought little children to Jesus, they said, suffer not little children to come to me. Who brought them to Christ? Their parents. They will not go themselves. He said, the parents brought the children to Christ, and we should do the same also. This is the first duty of every parent here, he said, to bring, and we should not relax until that is accomplished. It is true that when they reach certain ages, you know, they make their own choice. Sometimes we can avoid that, you know, but we should feel that our responsibility with the Lord is being done. It is being done. You know, lambs, our lambs need a special care, special attention, special encouragement, you know. We need to put them occupied in it says, the history of Daniel and his youthful companion has been recorded on the pages of the inspired word for the benefit of the youth of all succeeding generations. Through the record of the fidelity of the principle of temperance, God is speaking today to young men and to young women, bidding them gather up the precious rays of light he has given on the subject of Christian temperance and place themselves in right relation to the law of health. So God is seeking for the parents to do this work, to teach them about Daniel, to be like Daniel, so they can dare to be like Daniel, to be like Esther. And for that, we need a special care, special attention, a special devotion. In Isaiah chapter 40 and verse 10 and 11, here is the way that the responsibility of every parent here is delineated. Isaiah 40 verses 10 and 11, he said, "Behold, the Lord God will come with a strong hand, and his arm shall rule for him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his work before him. He shall feed his flock like a shepherd. He shall gather the lambs with his arms and carry them in his bosom, and shall gently lead those that are with young." So this quality here mentioned is, we cannot just lambs, you have to carry them in your arms. So showing that a special dedication is needed, a special attention, a special instruction is needed. It said, "He shall gather his lamb in his arm and carry them in his bosom." So that's the work of a true shepherd, a true mother and father in Israel. The best school for health reform is at the family table. You know, it's by principle and example. This is the best school that anyone can educate, be educated. The best school for language study is the home. Is to listen to the expression made by parents. The best school for music is also the peace and happiness of the home. This is the best school for music. So every home, every Christian home should be an educated center. And for that, Christ is calling the young people today and the parents as well. Said the call today is, let your light so shine before men. But before our light can shine anywhere, you need to shine where? In the home. In our family circle. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. This is Matthew chapter 5 and verse 16. In Prophets and Kings, page 222, Prophets and Kings 222, it said, "To everyone who become a partaker of his grace, the Lord appoint a work for others. Every enterprise in which he engages should be a mean to the witnessing for Christ." So this is the challenge that we have today. For such a time like this, where are the Esthers? Where are the Daniels? Are we witnessing for Christ? These are the questions that we need to ask. I have a few personal questions here that I want everyone to think about. Say, are you a member of the church? Then how faithfully do you support your church and promote God's work? How faithfully do we do that? We fail to realize that our children are watching us. They see what we do. If we neglect God's work, they will do it normally. You know, without any planning, they will do it normally. If they see that we are unfaithful, if they see our behavior, they will copy that most likely. You know, so then how faithfully do we support the church? How faithfully we represent the membership that we hold? Do we bear an office in the church? So then how well do you strive to perform your duties? All these things are lessons that, you know, you don't have to speak. Children will copy most likely. They will. Are you young and inexperienced? Are you young? You know, what are you doing? Then what are you doing to gain an experience to prepare yourself for the Lord's work, for his return? What are you doing to that? You know, don't think in yourself or feel yourself excused like a Mordecai told Esther. Don't think in yourself anything. You know, you can think whatever you want, say, but nevertheless, this is your responsibility. You know, you have to give an account to the Lord. Salvation is something which is individual. You know, I cannot be saved in groups or in partnership with others. Say, then what are you doing to gain an experience with the Lord or to take your stand for him? I was so encouraged in the past a few months that we have seen young people taking their stand, you know, and actually in Miami, which is the southern part of Florida, the last baptism we had has been young people. In one baptism, we have three young, and the oldest one among these three was 21 years of age. So the other was 19, 20, and 21. So that was an encouraging baptism. And last month, there was another baptism of a young girl. She was 14. And last week, I had two young ladies came to me and say, I want to be prepared for baptism. So this is encouraging, you know. These are the Esthers of this generation. For such a time like this, you are called. You know, it doesn't matter where you found. You may be the queen, or you may be a teacher or a student. But the question is, what are you doing? How are you fulfilling God's will? How are you listening to the call from God? So this is the thing. Have you nothing to do? Then lift up the hands of the weary and pray for those who are bearing heavy loads. You know, so there is a work to do for everyone. Inner circle. This is the thing that God is calling everyone, especially the youth. You know, so we read the prophecy that in these last days, the young people will play a very important role. They will do great things. So they will see visions, they will prophesy, they will preach, they will be witnessing to another young people. And this is what Satan feared the most. He is as a roaring lion seeking who to devour. He had prepared many things, many ways to take the young people away from God. Have you backslidden? Then what are you doing to rectify your position? Think for a moment that Esther could have said, look, this is not my problem. I will not be destroyed with the Jews. So she could have decided many things. Or maybe think about, oh, being the queen, how can I identify myself with these lower class people? She didn't think that way. She was very determined to stand, you know, stand for the right. Does the heaven fall? Now, in Romans chapter 13, in verses 11 and 12, the Apostle Paul has a special appeal for all of us, especially the young people. Romans 13, verses 11 and 12 said, and that knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep, For now is our salvation nearer than when we believe. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. He said, this is now the time to awake out of sleep. Many young people, they are here with us today. You know, within a few more years, they will not be with us. So the devil may put them busy in some other different enterprises. So that's what I have seen in our church, everywhere. So today is that time. So the night is far spent, the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. This is and in selected messages, book 1, page 67, it says, the angels of God in their messages to men represent time as very short. So the message from God, he said, that the way she received from the angels, the message, he said that the time is very, very short. How short? We don't know. But it's very short. He said, thus it has always been presented to me. It is true that time has continued longer than we expected in the early days of this message. Our Savior did not appear as soon as we hoped. But has the word of God failed? And then she answered, never, never. Why is it that the Lord has not come yet? So because the Lord is patient. Mm-hmm. He's waiting. He sees us here that we are in the Laodicean condition, and he sees the way we do things. He said, no, they're not ready. I will give them a few more days, a few more years. So, but how long more? We don't know. He said, knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep. It is high time. So, and this issue of the time is very short. You don't have a whole lot of time, you know, and God can call every one of us today. And the appeal from him is not just to young people, but to parents, to children, to everyone. As it says in volume 5, page 136, it said, when the religion of Christ is most held in contempt, when his law is most despised, then should our zeal be the warmest and our courage and firmness the most unflinching. So today we see laws are changing. People are getting a different views of life. You know, you see how many laws are being accepted and being, every day there is another state approving marijuana as a, you know, that you can use, no problem. They're gay married and you name it. You know, people are looking life differently today. Not according to the biblical principle. You know, so those who advocate biblical principle, they are looked as a, you know, old fashions, and you will witness all that in universities and schools and places of work. All these things is accepted as a normal. Now, what are we going to do is my question, you know. He said, when the religion of Christ is most held in contempt, when his law is most despised, then should our zeal be the warmest and our courage and firmness the most unflinching. To stand in defense of truth and righteousness when the majority forsake us. To fight the battles of the Lord when champions are few, this will be our test. So you see something similar to the time of Esther. So the whole Jewish people was going to be destroyed. And unless the intervention of someone or somebody that will be used as instrument, say then deliverance wouldn't have come. Now, Mordecai said, okay, if you are located in such a condition right now as the queen, maybe it depends on you for such a time like this. But that's a choice that you make. You know, who knows, he said, very carefully. He didn't say directly, say, oh, you are placed here for this time, and you have to do this. No, he said, who knows if you had been placed in such a position right now for such a time like this. Then she was inspired by that. He said, if this is the case, I will do faithfully. I will be one of the champions. He says that, to stand in defense of truth and righteousness when the majority forsake us, to fight the battles of the Lord when champions are few, this will be our test. This is your test. It is my test. He said, at this time, we must gather warmth from the coldness of others, courage from their cowardice, and loyalty from their treason. So this is what we need to do. This is our calling, brethren, today. It doesn't matter where are you, what is your position, what are you doing in life, whether if you're a nurse, you're a teacher, if you're a student, if you are a child growing up, you know, it's a time to take your stand for the Lord. You know, the time is at hand. The time is very short. And God is waiting for that. He's waiting for that determination. He said, I don't care what my brother or my friend do. Say, I will do what is right with the Lord. I will take my stand with him, you know, and the consequences will be of eternal nature, you know. So may the Lord help us that we may be inspired in this time, you know, that you do the Lord's will in such a time like this. So it is my wish and prayer. Amen. Amen.
Wouldn't you like to be a champion? Amen. Let us close our divine service and let us unite our voices and sing together hymn number 381. Hymn number 381. Thank you.
prayer with Brother Paredes.
Our Father, which art in heaven, we thank you so much for bringing us all together this Sabbath morning. We thank you for the many blessings you have given us and for calling each one of us to stand like a brave. Father, we thank you for the beautiful stories we have in the Bible.
So inspiring, so encouraging legacy that you have given us in Esther, in Daniel, and Joseph, and many other young people that stood for the right, even on the risk of their own life. And we recognize, Father, that we are far from them, that many times we fail, that many times we fall short. But we pray that you may give us the same determination, the same courage you gave them, so we can stand for the right, does the heaven fall. And we pray especially that you may work in the heart of our youth. Help them, guide them, so they can make the decision for you, so they can be one of those pillars in thy church, because they will play a very important role in these last days. And we haven't seen the end yet because you're waiting for us. And Father, thank you for thy patience. Help us to redeem the time. Help us to be brave and determined today to make it right. And we pray for every family here represented and every parent. Give us wisdom. Give us such an heart that may experience what Nicodemus experienced, the new birth, that conversion may be transmitted to our children in such a way that they may be guided by you, by thee, and they will be converted as well. So thank you, Father, for the many blessings. We can now express our gratitude to you, and we pray that your blessing continue with us in this afternoon and with all thy children spread out around the world. Bless us and guide us. We ask all these mercies, not because we're worthy, but in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, we thank you for being here today, and we pray that this message, that we think on it, and we never know for such a time as this. And at this time, we're dismissed.
Thank you. Don't give up.